I think we need some light in the audience. Is that okay? It's so nice to see people when you are going to talk to them. Welcome, everyone. Velkommen, alle sammen. This meeting will be mainly in English, but if some of you feel more comfortable with asking in Norwegian, feel free to do so, and we try to translate as we go. We have visitors from abroad, from Sweden, that's very far away, and from Uganda, that is even further away, but most of you come from Norway. So the question we are going to ask today is if GMOs can provide more food security, especially when it comes to production in Africa. And the reason why we ask this question today is that it's the UN's World Food Day today. And that means that these kind of questions is asked throughout the world. And that we are trying to work together for a zero hunger world in 2030. And the headline of the action from the UN is "Our actions are our future." So we do need to focus on the fact that the world's population is increasing. We will be more billion people in just a few years, and we really need to increase the food production, and especially when it comes to the African continent. What we would like to highlight is if products made with new gene editing technologies could help solve the problem, what kind of questions we should link to that. I'm very happy that we have, you know, several introductions to this topic today from different Norwegian researchers, but also from Sweden and Africa. We know that there will be a more rapid increase in the African population compared to any other parts of the world, but we also know that there is an extreme poverty, especially in the sub-Saharan countries. And we do also know that there is a high potential to increase food production in Africa compared to other parts of the world. And then we know that climate change is a big challenge. We just received the report, 1.5 degrees report, on Monday, last Monday, a week ago, highlighting the big benefits of managing to keep the increased global warming to 1.5 degrees versus 2 degrees. And that has to do with food production. It has to do with a lot of other extreme events connected to food production, especially heat waves and lack of water. So the next question will be if new gene editing technologies could help develop agriculture to be more resistant to drought or to extreme events. So that is what we are going to highlight today. And our first speaker will be Trine Woslef Eide. And she is a professor in applied plant biotechnology at the Faculty of Biosciences at NMBU, that's the Norwegian University of Life Sciences. She is a very experienced researcher and has been working on these topics for very many years, and we are so happy that you are here today. So please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Kristin. Thank you for inviting me to come here today.
I am invited to give you something of the technology background, and I'm going to give you some examples of what we are talking about. I'm going to give a brief introduction on conventional plant breeding so that you just know what we're talking about. I'll be moving on to modern plant breeding on transformation techniques and gene editing. And those of you who are very aware of these things, I ask you to excuse me, but I would like to bring the whole audience on the same page. And then I'll give some examples from Africa in banana, inset, and for the future, sweet potato. This is... why doesn't it work? Okay, never mind. The picture shows a banana plant in Uganda, which has been infected... With bacterial wilt. I'll come back to that later. Conventional plant breeding is traditionally used is crossbreeding, selection, and mutation breeding, where we just give chemicals or irradiation to induce mutations, and that is random mutations, and that has been much debated lately because of gene editing methods where we can use precise mutations, and these techniques have been compared and discussed for that reason. Polyploidization is increasing the ploidy level. Normally, organisms are diploid, but if you increase the ploidy level, each cell becomes bigger, so the produce becomes bigger. So that is a way of creating more yield. And also wide hybridizations to include new resistance genes into the population. So this is conventional plant breeding. And that's all I'm going to say about that. I'm going to move on to plant transformations. Normally, when we talk about plant transformations, the most opposed against in that is transgenes. So transgenesis is to the left. You would take a foreign gene from a plant or another organism, because DNA is so similar that we could take the genes from virtually any organism and put it behind a plant promoter and get it expressed in the plant. So that's crossing boundaries that nature normally sets. So you can talk about transatlantic flights crosses the Atlantic. Transgenesis is crossing nature's boundaries, while cisgenesis on the right is a genetic modification where the gene comes from the same or a sexually crossable species. An example could be resistance against botrytis in wild strawberries, and then you put that into farmed strawberries and get botrytis resistance that way. And that's cisgenesis, and I would like you to have learned that from today, that there's a difference between transgenesis and cisgenesis. And then intragenesis is when you rearrange the genetic composition of the plant itself. So that's also a possibility. So I see that I need to put all these, yeah. So there are lots of possibilities with transformation, and you think that maybe that we are only trying to produce genetically modified plants for the world, but actually it's most used to study gene functions. We can overexpress genes, we can introduce novel genes, we can have gene silencing and suppressing gene expression, and that way we can study how plants function in plants. And that is the most used. That's why we do it. Most researchers use this to study plant development. But then you can also make genetically modified organisms for improved varieties. And the reason this is so enchanting is that you can alter only one or two of the genes and keep the rest of the genome intact. And for vegetatively propagated plants like potatoes, bananas, strawberries, raspberries, a lot of plants that we eat and cultivate are vegetatively propagated.
And that means that we can use that new organism directly as a variety. For seed-propagated plants, you can bring these genes into the breeding lines to induce novel genes not presently in the gene pool, for instance, disease resistance. So these are the possibilities. The most used method is using a natural soil bacterium that causes crown gall disease in plants. It infects the roots. And if you see that little blue T-DNA inside the circular tie plasmid in the cell, that's an agrobacterium cell. That little blue T-DNA is then transferred to the plant cell. And this is nature's own way of transformation. And actually, it was found 2 years ago, I think, that sweet potatoes have been transformed with agrobacterium. So they are transgenic. So that's interesting in itself. The researchers the gene technologists have taken away the disease, so they don't cause crown disease anymore. The agrobacterium is dependent upon plants to multiply. But we use this ability to deliver the genes by inserting the gene of interest into the tie plasmid and then make the transgenic. And this is what is pictured here. We co-integrate with the agrobacterium, get a transformed cell. We let them grow out in the petri dishes. We put them into medium for selection to find the 3 to 5% that have been transformed. And then we get the plant that grows out of that is transgenic, in this case, a tobacco plant. And examples of agrobacterium transformations is from banana in Uganda, actually. I'm sure you are aware of this, Dennis, that IITA have produced resistant banana plants against bacterial wilt. And they have had 5 years of field trials of this in Uganda. And the reasoning behind this is that there's a lot of banana plantations in Uganda that are affected by this disease, and it's quite devastating. And bananas account for about 50% of the calories consumed in Uganda. And here you can see from Lina Tripathi's publication that the picture D is a stem from a healthy plant, and F is bacterial wilt. And you can see beneath the E is healthy bananas, and G are infected with bacterial wilt, and they are totally non-edible. Even the animals don't want them. So, and you can see how devastating they are in there. And you can see that again, this picture. The control plants have totally wilted, while the bacterial wilt resistant plant are healthy. So this is a product that could be on the threshold of the market in Uganda, if the Ugandan authorities wants to. Bacterial wilt is also a problem in NSAID in Ethiopia, and I doubt how many of you know what NSAID. How many of you have heard about NSAID? Oh, well, not too bad. It's also called the false banana in Ethiopia. It's endemic to Ethiopia, and it's grown only there. And I think you have to have an acquired taste for it to really enjoy it, because it doesn't really taste nice. But it is a very important plant in Ethiopia, because it grows for 7 years in the field, but you can harvest it before. But the optimal is harvesting after 7 years. And that means that if there's a bad year for other crops, you still have food to eat. It's an important starch for Ethiopia. So it's like having food in the bank when you have that in the field. And Ethiopia say that if you have really fat, big NSAID plantations, then you're a rich farmer, because you can afford to wait for 7 years before you harvest it. So in Nairobi, we have a PhD student who's going to finish this winter. And he's been doing exactly the same in NSAID as they did in banana. And they are going to They are testing it as we speak. They have been inoculated, so we are very eager to see whether they are also resistant against bacterial wilt. The way this works is that there are two genes that give a hypersensitive response to the bacterial wilt. That means that all the cells around the infection site die and contain the bacterial wilt in that spot, so it doesn't spread. I have to use the last few minutes on CRISPR, gene editing. This is a method that comes from bacteria. It's the way that bacteria fight viral infections. It's an adaptive immune system, and it destroys viral DNA. And it can be used in all organisms to disrupt a gene, give a targeted mutation, which cannot be detected afterwards. You can exchange a dysfunctional gene. If you have a gene that is causing some problems in the organism, you can change it with a healthy gene. Or you can insert a novel gene, like disease resistant, if you want to do that. So there are lots of possibilities with CRISPR. And CRISPR also needs the same delivery methods that we have used for, now it's called conventional biotechnology or gene transformations, which is, I find, quite interesting. It's not that old, but it's already conventional. There you don't know where in the genome this will be inserted. Using CRISPR, you can precisely target where you want to make the mutation, exchange the gene, or insert a novel gene. So this is the novelty of gene editing, that you can be much more precise in what you're doing. So I'm going to give you the last example. In sweet potatoes, we are working on sweet potatoes in Ethiopia, and we have eliminated viruses in 5 genotypes, and I don't have time to go into how we did that. We do it through cell and tissue culture. And in field trials, at the moment, we are checking out how long it will take before they are reinfected. If these are reinfected very quickly, then it's too costly to do this virus elimination. It's very similar. We do this in potatoes in Norway. And farmers buy new seed potatoes every 5 years because it takes about 5 years before you need to change. If that is the case in Ethiopia too, then they can use the same system that we have in Norway. If they are reinfected too quickly, then we could do gene editing with CRISPR to create plants with an autoimmune response to destroy the viruses that destroy yields in the Ethiopia. So that's something for the future, if necessary. So in conclusion, Africa, I think, deserves to be given the best tools to promote increased yield. I think it's interesting to look at the aims of the Norwegian Technology Act, which I think is a very good act, because it should have a low risk for human health and environment, which is good. It says it should promote a sustainable development, which is also very good. It should be beneficial to society and ethically justifiable. All of these aims are very good aims. And if you look at them as a total, then if you have something that could really help promote yields and reduce poverty and hunger, then I think you have a benefit to society, which is ethically justifiable. I mean, if it is a low risk to human health and environment and promotes a sustainable development, then I think this should go forward also in Africa. Sadly, Africa takes after Europe's very strict attitude towards GMOs, which I think they deserve better. I'm not saying that we should promote all GMOs, because it should be a case by case, and it should be a precautionary principle behind it. But we could be too cautious and should open up our minds to some of these products. So I think plant diseases will be a natural first target in Africa. It will eliminate the need for chemical sprays, and that will protect the farmers and the environment, and it will increase yields to combat hunger. So I would like to write on target. I would like to thank all my students and co-workers over the years. There are so many, I can't even list them in a slide. So none mentioned, none forgotten. And thank you for listening.
Thank you so much. I really love when professor thanks the students, because I think students often ask questions that help professors find the extremely interesting research questions, and then they help developing science. Any questions? No, you're too. Maybe they are a bit shy. Should we open for questions in Norwegian?
Does that help?
Yep, please.
Are there any negative effects of gene?
Are there any negative effects of genredigering,
gene editing?
Gene editing.
Of course.
For example, CRISPR.
It could be. Yes, I could think of a lot of negative effects, but they will be regulated. And so you would have to look at them case by case, and you would have to have a precautionary principle to make sure that if they seem to be negative, then we shouldn't use them. But it will be what is the most important to look at is the gene you put into the organism, and then the new characters that the organism acquires from this, and what risks this will have. So this will have to be assessed naturally. But we do that in plant breeding already. We already discard most of what we are crossing because they are not any use to us. Okay? So we are used to eliminating those that shouldn't be put forward.
Yeah, a gentleman in the back, please.
Jo, du sa at du syntes det var litt synd at afrikanske land ikke hadde like lett retningslinjer som europeiske land på slutten.
No, I didn't say that they don't have the same
Du syntes det var synd, sa du.
But it's the reality is that in African countries they have taken after the European laws and European attitudes, and that has to do with where Africa exports their food. Mostly, and the tight connections with the former colonies in Europe, I'm sorry to say. But I think Africa could benefit from having a more open mind and actually some of the African countries are very, very strict on GMOs. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, any other question? Yeah, a follow-up from you, please. We'll come back to questions and discussions, just so that will be the last one.
If I somehow managed to gene edit a potato at home, could you tell if I had gene edited that potato? Is it possible to tell?
That depends on what you have done. If you have created a mutation, I could tell that there was you could find the Cas9 protein. But if you had removed the Cas9 protein, that does the job. Then nobody could tell. And there are ways to remove that. If you have exchanged a gene that is in the plant already with a healthy one, it would be about the same answer, because you would have some that are healthy in the population. If you have inserted a gene that is not in the population, then one could suspect that it's been done. But you couldn't be totally sure.
So it's not easy to trace, but you could have some kind of certificates or something that you have to tell what you've been doing.
Can I add something to
that? Yes, please.
This is why I think that the Biotechnology Advisory Board's suggestion that we had on the hearing on that the threshold for the different danger levels, to put it that way, that there should be a low threshold to report on gene editing with no added DNA. And the medium threshold for the cisgenesis that I tried to explain to you, and then remain have the same threshold and the same requirements today as for the transgenics. I think that will promote people to actually be honest and report.
Okay. Yeah. But at the lowest level, the authorities always could say, okay, we'll move this application from the lowest level to the second or the third level, if they have concerns when it comes to the product or the technology. So, thank you so much, Trine. We'll come back with discussions and questions. I think I forgot to tell you that it is the biotechnology, the Norwegian Council of Biotechnology that is behind this meeting, inviting to this meeting, and that my name is Kristin Halvorsen. I know that, you know, this feels like a cozy audience. We all know each other, but this meeting is also streamed. And that means that every question you ask will be distributed to the rest of the world. Yes. And you will be famous, and yeah, you know how it goes. Okay, the next speaker will be Ida Tarjem. She is now a PhD candidate at the Department of International Environment and Development Studies, also at the NMBU, where she will investigate the relationship between GMOs and gender equality in the African communities. So please, Ida.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
I'm ready for my 15 minutes of fame, right?
Yes. Yes. You are. Use that 15 minutes.
Well, yes. Yeah. Okay, so as Kristin Halvorsen said, well, she didn't say it, but I obtained my master's in biotechnology about a year ago. And this was really when my interest for GMOs started to blossom, because I was lucky enough to go to Kenya to work on genetically modified bananas, thanks to my then supervisor, Trine. So there I was, all the way from Norway, feeling really enthusiastic about working on GMOs. And then literally, the day after I arrived, I was confronted by this whole GMO debate by none other than the driver who was taking me to the institution where I was going to work. And actually, the top picture here is from inside the lab where I worked. So he had brought up the topic completely unprovoked. We had been driving past these African crops, which in my eyes were really exotic. But he said that he had observed a declining biological diversity of these crops. And he was afraid that GMOs would make matters worse. He also said, how can I trust a government that once allowed for the commercialization of cigarettes? What if GMOs turn out to be just as bad? And while this is the opinion of just one person, of course, his concerns are not unique. However, when I went out to the rural countryside to talk to farmers, as you can see in the lower photo here, talk to farmers about how they felt about GMOs, they were really enthusiastic, or many of them were. They said, or they believed that this technology could help them feed their families in the face of drought, floods, pests and diseases. So as you understand, the debate on GMOs is more relevant than perhaps ever, not just in Kenya, but in large parts of the African continent. Personally, I think it's well beyond time that we move away from the notion that all GMOs are synonymous with overuse of pesticides, monopoly control, and commercial forces. So my role here today is to show you some examples of promising GMOs that could hopefully one day actually benefit these rural poor farmers. So this is what I'm going to cover in today's presentation. And the first thing I want to do is contextualize this today's topic a bit. Because the agriculture sector in Africa is incredibly important. In many African countries, the agriculture sector contributes around 30% of the gross domestic product, while the global average is 3.8%. The sector also employs about 60 to 70% of the labor force, while the global average is about 26%. And in recent years, we've seen a renewed interest for incorporating agriculture into the development agenda. And though it's debated, some believe that the answer to poverty reduction, economic growth, and sustainable development lies in agriculture. One thing is for certain, there are plenty of challenges to deal with. You can probably not even see all of these or read them properly, But they range from socioeconomic and political conditions to environmental and climatic factors to biotic constraints. And it is in this context that we need to consider the opportunities and challenges of GMOs in Africa. So that brings us to today's big question. Can GMOs be part of the solution? So this figure shows that in 2017, there was a total of 13 African countries involved in the development of 12 different types of GM crops, possessing one or more of 14 different traits. And in the countries colored green, or deep green, that's Sudan and South Africa, GM planting material, or GM seeds, are commercially available to farmers. And after this figure was produced, Nigeria has also allowed for the commercialization of GM cotton. Also, there are indications of an increasingly more liberal attitude towards GMOs in several other African countries, including those that allow for field trials of GMOs. So that's, for instance, Ethiopia and Tanzania. Before we have a closer look at some of these GMOs, I just want to add that in more or less all of the cases I'm about to show you, the seeds is to be delivered royalty-free to farmers. This means that it will be available at a price similar to that of conventionally bred varieties. So have a look at this incredible female farmer. I mean, this is truly the picture of Mama Africa, right? Her name is Salma Seleman, and she's from Tanzania. Then imagine this horrible drought, and I think we all got a little taste of that this summer, right? But once the crop is weakened by drought, a horrible infestation of pest comes, and you're left with nothing more than this shriveled up corn cob. And Salma, she is far from alone. Maize is the most widely food crop grown in Africa. And over 300 million people are dependent on maize for food. However, 90% of the maize is dependent on rainwater, and up to 25% of the cultivated areas are exposed to frequent droughts. However, the biggest losses occur when you have both drought and pest at the same time. So the question is, how can we help farmers such as Salma? So the water-efficient maize for Africa, the VIMA project, is probably the most highly profiled biotech project in Africa. It has already developed drought and insect-resistant maize, both through conventional breeding, so that's the drought tegu, that's only drought-tolerant varieties, and then through transgenics, and that's the Tela variety. So Tela consists of two types. You have one type that has the gene for insect resistance, and then another type that has both the gene for insect resistance and one for drought tolerance. And this first variety here has been commercially available for farmers in South Africa since 2016, while the latter variety is being tested in field trials in Kenya, Uganda, Mozambique, and soon also Tanzania and Ethiopia. So let's move on to my favorites, and that's bananas and plantains, or Musa species. They are actually, they cover about 25% of the energy requirements for over 100 million people in Africa. That makes them the fourth most important food crop on the continent. And I remember being in the computer lab in Kenya one day when one of my co-workers and now close friends, she just come and like dumped this huge bag of deeply green bananas in my lap. And I just sat there with the biggest question mark on my face saying, what am I supposed to do with these? These aren't going to be ripe in ages. And then she just kind of chuckled and said, no, these are cooking bananas. Matoke, you cook them as you would cook a potato. I think for me, that just made me realize how much more bananas are than just the Cavendish varieties that we get in our supermarkets, right? And how much they mean to so many people. Unfortunately, as Trina has already mentioned, bananas are exposed to a variety of diseases, including this bacterial disease, Banana Xanthomonas wilt. And it's an extremely aggressive disease. You can have a completely healthy plantation one day, and then just a few weeks later, it just withered and died. You can see Lena Tripathi holding a withered banana plant there at the top. But as Trina said, the researchers at the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture, where I worked during my master's, they managed to create these resistant bananas. And they did this by transferring two genes from paprika that enhances the natural defense system of the plant. I also want to mention a project called Banana 21. It's Ugandan and Australian scientists that have worked together on this project. And because bananas are low in vitamin A and iron, this poses a problem in countries such as Uganda, where bananas is the main staple, because this can lead to vitamin A deficiencies among children and women, which can lead to problems with the eyesight, blindness, impaired brain development, and a weakened immune system. So in response to this, the Banana 21 project has developed these golden bananas, as you can see here, with four times the amount of vitamin A as conventional types. And they did this by transferring a gene from a banana that is naturally rich in vitamin A. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is cassava. It looks like a tree, but it's actually a woody shrub. And it produces these impressive underground tubers that you can see here in A. And cassava is consumed by 500 Africans each day, and sometimes as often as three times a day. And it's also very important in a food security perspective because it can be cultivated in low-quality soil and with limited water supply. However, viral diseases such as cassava mosaic disease, CMD, and cassava brown streak disease, CBSD, can cause total losses. And in this picture, you can see cassava infected with CMD, so a healthy cassava in B, moderate infection with CMD in C, and then a serious infection in D there. And the difference is just crazy, right? B, you can probably feed a whole family, or even more, and then there's nothing left. So the virus-resistant cassava for Africa project, or the Verka project, they managed to create these transgenic CBSD-resistant cassavas. And they tested these in field trials in Uganda and Kenya so far. Then they tried to combine this transgenic CBSD resistance with cassava varieties that are naturally resistant to CMD. What they discovered then was that the natural CMD resistance was lost. I think this is such a great example of how complex plant science and genetics can be. Traits often depend on a variety of genes that interact in these intricate networks, and they can interact with the environment. So it really makes breeding quite challenging. And so the scientists are currently trying to correct for this. So far, I've shown you three examples of GMOs that I find particularly interesting. I just want to acknowledge that there are so many more projects, and unfortunately, I do not have time to go into much detail on these. But I just want to quickly skim through some of these in the next few slides. So work is being done on rice, and rice is actually the fastest growing source of food south of the Sahara. You have sorghum, where they managed to increase the amount of vitamin A by 140 times that of conventional types. Trine mentioned sweet potato, and I think the fact that sweet potato is considered a natural GMO is quite a fun fact. So researchers have shown that sweet potatoes from across the world, they contain DNA from Agrobacterium, which Trine explained is the bacteria, or the family of bacteria, that they use to transfer genes to plants in the lab. And finally, cowpea, insect-resistant cowpea. And cowpea is a legume that is known as the poor man's meat, because it's a cheap source of high-quality protein. However, in this day and age, you can't really do a presentation on GMOs without mentioning gene editing. Unfortunately, there isn't that much information about what's going on in terms of research activities using gene editing, but I do know that at the institution where I worked, at IITA, they are using gene editing in bananas and plantains. And this picture was actually taken at a gene editing seminar workshop hosted by the IITA. And this was the first of its kind in Africa. This was earlier this year. And also last year, the Academy of Sciences in South Africa, they released a report where they concluded that the regulatory system in South Africa can, without too many changes, also be applied to gene-edited products. They also encourage decision makers and politicians in African countries to make sure that they're able to accommodate the changes that are now taking place. However, we can talk all we want about the regulatory and the technical aspects of gene modification and editing, but that really is of little importance if consumers and farmers are not willing to embrace such products. Unfortunately, perception surveys of GMOs in Africa are quite few and they're far in between, but the ones that do exist sometimes show contradictory results, but at least quite a few of those I've come across do indicate a relatively high level of positive attitudes, which is consistent with my own findings from Kenya, from farmers in Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. So some of the perceived advantages is high yield and income, disease and pest resistance, tolerance to climate change, and higher nutritional value. Nevertheless, they do express concerns, including potential health and environmental risks, cultural and ethical misgivings, limited market access, and higher priced planting material or seeds. Also, commonly in these studies is quite a low level of awareness and knowledge of the underlying technology. And low level of awareness isn't the only issue you run into when you start discussing the introduction of GMOs in Africa. Indeed, why have certain African countries only recently started to explore this technology or lagged behind in terms of regulations and policy making? So the answer to that question is incredibly complex, and it cannot be understood outside of the wider political and historical context. However, on this slide, I just summed up a few points to give you an impression of what is really fueling this debate. And among the most discussed issues is who will become the real winners if GMOs, or when GMOs, are commercialized? Will it be the multinational companies or the smallholder? Will it be the large commercial farms or the small-scale farmers? Will it be men or women, or must it be really either or? Is there any point of introducing GMOs if farmers do not have enough water to sustain these, not enough storage space, or if they cannot bring this produce to a functional market? Does African governments have enough resources to sustain this technology and its associated regulations, or the will to do so? Or perhaps there is some invisible forces originating from outside Africa that may use market access, trade, and development assistance to win African countries over to their side, or what is often depicted as this GMO Cold War, where pro and anti-GMO organizations are digging the trenches even deeper. Indeed, has the African continent just become this dumping ground for a struggling GMO industry and a laboratory for frustrated GMO researchers? So I started this presentation by showing you some of the extent and diversity of the challenges that African farmers face. And perhaps it is this daunting image that is now sparking an interest for GMOs among several African governments. And I showcased a number of examples of GMOs that are currently being developed, which include important African food crops and properties that small-scale farmers value, not just commercial and industrial agricultural interests. And I just want to conclude by saying that I think it's well beyond time that we move beyond the static yes, no, either or entrenchment that has characterized so much of the debate so far. And I hope that maybe my presentation can contribute to this by showing some of the diversity that exists out there. And really, as the Norwegian expression goes, at alle GMO-er ikke bør skjæres over en kam. I would just want to leave you, with this quote by a Kenyan farmer I met. Fear of the unknown and trying new things can sometimes make people very poor. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much, Ida. Any questions for Ida? Det blir et litt annet panel. the panelists after will contain some different people. So please use the opportunity if you have some questions for Ida. Or you'll stay. So if you would like to comment on the panelists, you could do so later. Yes. Yeah, here's a question for you.
Hey, my name is Dad. I don't have a real question, but I have opportunities for what direction we goes into and what situation we are today. Like we can see, the time is going the wrong direction. We have CO2 not under control. By change genetic and food, I don't think it's the right thing to do. We have to go back to our genetic roots and do things the way we used to do. Hunger will always be in this world. Population balance, population will balance with production. Like, if we produce more food, it will come more people. And if we go in that way, we cannot control the CO2 that the crisis we are in today. And by finding new opportunities to overproduce will not working if we're going to cut down the CO2. Otherwise, I think we have to focus on 1/3 of the food we're throwing away. I think that's the key, because we already produced that one. The goal with organic economic is going to the farms. It's not good thing that a farmer produce for 6 farmers. Go back to organic, spread the work and the knowledge, and let people work in small part. And that's mean we have to. That's make more workers and cut more workers in the fabric for the material.
I'm sorry. I think I have to stop you there. I think this is a very important point. I'll ask Ida to comment shortly, and then we'll proceed. And then you can come back later.
Yes, please.
Thank you so much.
That's difficult to comment because you raised so much, and I agree with a lot of things that you say. I mean. Population growth is the reason why, or the biggest reason why we have climate change, right? So why would we kind of fuel up under a population growth? And I agree that food loss is incredibly important and should be combated. There's a lot of food just going to waste, and often this is a problem of distribution. We are producing enough food today. It's just distributed unequally around the world. So I agree with a lot of the things that you say. Not sure about the organic, because then you would need a lot of more space if you were only to produce organically.
It makes us keep the farmers and take the fabric, unless we have to keep the nature growing from there.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I just have to stop you there, because our next speaker, he's come from far away. thank you.
Thank you.
Feel free to come back and comment or I'll participate in the discussion later. Denise Kabito, he is the national coordinator or CEO for the Young Farmers Federation of Uganda, which is an umbrella body for all young farmers and aspiring young entrepreneurs in Uganda. Kabito is currently the facilitator for the Youth Committee of the World Farmers Organization, based in Rome. And Denise is a biologist by training. He's also an active farmer. You have time for all this, or?
Yeah.
Yes, he has time for everything. Yeah. He's also an active farmer in the Rakai district in central Uganda. So please, we are so happy to have you here.
Thank you so much. Yes. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege and honor to be here, and also a difficult one after hearing from the scientists speak about the topic of GMOs and what they're doing, especially within our country. But also, I'll also give my perspective as a farmer and a scientist of my level. And having come from far, like you've said, so I think I have more time for the presentation, but it's not going to be very scientific. It's more of what is happening within our society and what we are seeing within the farming world and what I've seen. Because you have talked about a lot of what you have done, especially in Uganda, Kenya, and Tanzania. And I have participated in some of those projects. Some of them have worked out, some of them have failed. So, yes, we might be producing breed for disease tolerance, but there's also some things that make it fail in terms of organoleptic parameters, especially with the bananas, for instance, that have been produced, and they are not palatable by the society. So that also prevents it from spreading. It might be coming out, but it's not being taken by the farmers because they produce it and no one is consuming. It's healthy, it's high yielding, but they are not eating it. So all those are some of the issues that are coming on because of all these. So we have to outweigh and see who are the winners. Like you said, it has to be the consumers, it has to be the farmers, because they have to be in the driving seat of all this. My presentation is a bit wide, like I've told, to have some agricultural challenges, to have a background, and then talk about the GMOs shortly. And then the agricultural challenges in large, and then the future of GMOs in Uganda, what is happening, and then have some conclusions. And starting with me, already I've been introduced. I'm Dennis, and I'm a farmer in the central part of Uganda. I own a farm. It's a small farm compared to Europe, but it's a big farm in our country, because the average size of a farm is between 0.5 hectares to 5 hectares. So if you have 10, you're having a bigger farm or a medium-sized farm. And I have poultry, I have bananas, I have maize, some of them we have talked about already here, and coffee and goats. I come from a family farm also, so my farm was for my grandparents, and the farm that I grew on is still existent. My father is 75 years old, but still owns his farm. And I'm a father also with a son. But also, I do coordinate other young farmers in the country, in the association, which is the Young Farmers Federation of Uganda. My other role is to facilitate the youth committee of the World Farmers Organization, where we have youth from around the globe in the World Farmers Organization, where we have a gymnasium, we learn together, but also we look at youth inclusion, more at advocacy and having the interests of youth and the voice of the youth heard globally, nationally, and regionally. About my organization, we are an umbrella organization for all youth in Uganda, but those that are interested in agriculture, between the age of 12 to 39. We look at youth that have the interest in agriculture, that are living in the rural areas, and those that are at school, because we want to interest these youth to go into the field of farming, which is still weak. And so that is why we formulated this organization, to see that we have youth across the country that would want to entice others to come into this business of agriculture, which is the biggest contributor to our GDP. We are bringing them to build young leaders to have synergy and relationships, but also to keep traditions and rural areas active. Moving on to my main part of the presentation. Yes, GMOs, a solution to the challenges in Africa or the global challenges. Poverty and hunger, which are some of the key global challenges. I flew in from Rome yesterday, and the FAO report, which is being given out today, has indicated that the number of undernourished people is increasing from 804 million to 821 million. And the majority of these are in the Afro-Caribbean, Pacific countries, but also some in Asia. And these people, coincidentally, are smallholders also, and they are producing food. But they are hungry, and many of them are dying of famine. And you see that 68% of the people in Africa rely on agriculture for incomes and for food, and 50% of these in Asia rely on agriculture. We need a lot of food by 2050. So we have to increase our production by almost 50%. However much, there are also some food wastes and losses within, but also we have also to look at the distribution of this food. Urbanization and food security. Why am I bringing this? Because many of the consumer sentiments, many of the issues that come with food, usually, especially in our context, stem from the urban areas. They would look at a particular kind of food, they might take it or they might not take it because of the improved standards and also because of the incomes. So the aspect that food is being taken of a given kind depends on one's level of income, level of education, and all that. In the previous presentations, I've heard about, yes, the optimism the farmers have with GMOs. Yes, when you go to a rural area, ask any farmer, would you want to have your yields improved? The farmer will say, yes. Would you want to have a disease-resistant variety? The farmer will say, yes. But is the yes out of consent? Or at what levels are these farmers, the literacy levels, the information that they get? Because it's also important. Yes, I will crave for the high yield, but have I looked at the other things that outweigh the high yields? Or is it that if I bring a GMO plant that is high yielding, I'm solving all the other problems? Because there are also other systemic problems that we as African farmers face apart from yield. And by doing things better, for instance, we can increase the yields. If you find that a smallholder, we are always disproportionating the land into small and meaningless units. This also reduces the yield. Because I'll give you an example. I own my grandparents' farm, and the average size of a farm of a family in Africa is 6 people, meaning six to eight people, meaning 2 parents and 6 children. So if one has 10 hectares, they have to disproportionate that land to the 6. It was one block, and then into small and meaningless units that they cannot produce enough from it. So there are so many challenges that are coming within the urbanization and food that bring about food insecurity, because there's increased demand for employment, increased demand for food, and then also the quality of food. We have, going back to Uganda, the population of Uganda is growing at 3.2%, and we are now estimated at 40 million people. But the young people below the age of 25 are 78% of that population. And agriculture is a sector that is currently the source of livelihood for many of these people. Because 70% of the people depend on this agriculture. And meaning that it's a very important sector for these people. What are the challenges? The first three are all global challenges that affect either a farmer here or a farmer in my country in Uganda. Climate change has no borders. And with this, we have seen the proliferation of pests and diseases. Because of this, the African fall armyworm is doing havoc. I had 4 hectares of maize, and it destroyed 3 hectares of my maize. One of the seasons. You spread, you do what and all that, but it doesn't work out. Market and trade, the conflicts. The farmers have no voice in these global value chains, which is a very, very big challenge because it's the biggest puller. If I want to increase my yields, if I want to expand my farm, the biggest puller is the market. If I have all the produce and I sell it very fast, I will always want to do more and I will always want to expand my farm. Generational renewal. The average age of a farmer is bordering to 60. My father is 75, my mother is 65. They still own their farm. And that's the case because it's their survival and it's their pension because of these, there are no social systems that can facilitate that. Many of the farmers are farming by default. The illiterate, low skills and know-how is less. So that's the point that I was trying to bring out, yes. Do you want to increase your yield? I'll say yes. At whatever cost, that is no other body's business. So we need to see the sanity in this. Am I talking to the farmers with the same intellectual levels? Or I might be coming from a lab with my vision. Is that vision the same to that of the farmer who is down in the fields there? Because it is important. And less all, many of these farmers are working alone. We want to usually work alone. We don't want to share our stories of success, which is also a problem. And then the policy environment and how it has affected the penetration of GMOs or the non-penetration of GMOs. That's why there was a distinction. There are some countries that are friendly and others that are a no-go area. And the cultural norms, I've talked about the girl child not having the rights to land. GMOs in Africa, so GMO crops, they're not very old. It's relatively new. It's not more than 2 decades. And the first commercialization was in South Africa in 1998. Where we are seeing a lot of these crops, and I think we have already alluded to that. And then, since then, Egypt, Burkina Faso, and Sudan have followed, and others. So now, yes, recently, as you have talked about, Nigeria is coming on board. Uganda was the closest to commercializing. It was the closest after these ones. But then, the steam is a bit dying. It's going down. Because it has tested on what has come out of research, it has, and all that. So there are several issues, and that is the part of my presentation. Why did we have that boom? And we had so many scientists coming in the Ugandan labs, and also had so many people bankrolling the research, but also bankrolling the politicians. But then why did we change? Why did the president not sign the act to have commercialized GMOs in Uganda? It's because there were some issues that had to be addressed. And Uganda became an emerging leader in biotechnology. Those who have been around will see that we have had some of our research stations worked upon. And there was will also from the government to bring in different people to help the researchers and to grow the research stations with support from DuPont, Acadia Bioscience, and Monsanto. They bankrolled many of our labs, and these have been good. And also, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation was also contributed a lot, especially in the production of maize and cassava. Incidentally, when I was starting to work, I worked on one of those projects, especially on the field trials of how these cassava would get onto the market and how the farmers would take it, because we participated in the farmer participatory research processes. And so we have had significant trials on cotton, on banana, maize, and cassava as Uganda. What was being brought on board was to tackle climate change. We have seen some of these drought tolerant varieties brought on board. And it was going to be part of my question, but later I was part of the panel, I didn't ask it earlier, that all that we have seen has been produced has been more of tolerance, not resistant. I haven't seen any of the labs in Kenya or Uganda produce resistant varieties, especially to the most rampant diseases that we have, especially like on cassava. You talked about cassava brown streak disease. All the varieties that are coming out are tolerant. In fact, one of the reasons as to why many of these have not penetrated the market is that after 5 to 6 years, the tolerance dies out. They also succumb. So there has still been a challenge in producing those varieties that we think are resistant to the limit, because it's still hard. And also, we have seen that it takes more than 10 to 15 years to produce these varieties. So it's still also a challenge. The widespread adoption of GMOs was a key to the government, because it bankrolled research and also brought in a lot of researchers. And therefore, there was need to legislate the commercialization of GMOs within our country, and this was brought to Parliament in 2010. So it was brought through the National Biosafety and Biotechnology Bill, 2012. It was first read in our Parliament in February 2013, and then it was deferred back for consultation in November 2013. So from that time, civil society and NGOs and farmers' pressure mounted, because each of the parties had to sensitize the public. The scientists who were supporting the GMOs had to inform the public about the good the GMOs can provide. And the other side also had to look at those goods, but also look at also the negative side of GMOs. So there has been a lot of debate. And the issues that you have talked about, especially the ethical and the limited market access, the high cost of planting, were outweighing the disease tolerance, the yield. Because we as the farmers were looking at, if I have a high yielding, a tolerant variety, but it's not marketable, why should I grow it? We are seeing the bananas that were produced from the farmer trials, they are not palatable. Yes, it is tolerant, but people don't want to eat it. The taste is totally different. So all these had to be looked into. And they had, these arguments were there, and the public had to gauge. So the bill was later introduced in 2016 and passed by the House in November 2017. Our system of passing and commercializing of, sorry, of passing laws, because here we are looking at a law that will commercialize or let the release of GMOs from the labs, because we have to accept the GMOs are already in our country, but they were still confined more into the labs. And they could no one could easily sell out or do sell these GMO products. But also the products were also being brought in by the chain stores, especially from South Africa. But many of these have now collapsed. Nakumat used to bring in a lot of chicken, a lot of bananas, a lot of maize, but all these have now collapsed. And the president did not sign this bill because there was an outcry from the farmers, the civil society, and the public. Why? The parliament had passed it because for the act to be, sorry, for the bill to be functional and to be implemented, the final step of it is for the president to sign it, then it becomes an act. So it stopped at being passed, and because there was a lot. Why? Why are there no GMOs commercialized for now? Because of the precautionary principle from the Cartagena Protocol that was being brought forward, especially on how we can safely transfer these products onto our fields, onto our market. There were still so many issues that what happens if it fails out? We have several varieties of beans. We have several varieties of rice. We have several varieties of species of oil. Because as you come to an African farm, you will understand what biodiversity means. So if we are going into having one crop, for instance, what happens if it fails? So all these were looked into, and the president could not sign it. In fact, for him, he said, if I lose, he's a herdsman, he has a lot of cattle, so he gave an example of, if I lose my Ankole cattle to this, say, let me go this, and it doesn't work out. Like we have seen with the cassava. It comes 5 years, then we need to look for a new variety. And the farmers stay scrambling for the next 5 or 6 years until a new variety is produced, which is a challenge. And they were, in our case, between the act that was being produced, they were favoring large-scale farming, having more of a monoculture, yet we have a mixed farm. This is partly due to our land tenure system and the diversity of crops that we have. So we were looking at not losing our biodiversity because the answers for biodiversity loss were not yet clear. And this is because we are still weak in research And there was no time to debate, to predetermine what will happen in the future. And then, if we had commercialized the GMOs, the rights of the indigenous owners were to be violated, because traditionally, grown crops, animal species, and materials must be adequately protected in case there's need to reverse the effects of biotechnology. We had no answer of that. And we were supposed to get seed from this supplier continuously, yet we have, like I've told you, our seed banks are not the best. We don't have tangible seed banks. Our seed banks are within us, the farmers. And we have several species of, like, varieties of beans, but they have been within us. So if we move with one, what happens? For us, we are seeing that instead of benefiting us, the cooperatives, commercializing of the GMOs was benefiting seed companies, the breeders, and the scientists. And the scientists were, whenever, because I was then also in the farm organization, bring them to our discussion. We were only talking about the positive. Let us increase the yield. Let us fight the drought. But then when we brought in the aspects, the ethical issues, the market, they wouldn't mind. And for us, it was important, because if we don't look at the other side of the coin, then it's a problem, unless we are given those answers. And it was to increase costs along the agro value chain, because always we have to buy these patented seed. We have our own system of sharing seed, and we were to buy seed often. Like I said earlier, we have been having GMOs on our market. Yes, in the Ugandan market, because we had chain stores. But because they were not labeled. We had chain stores from South Africa. And they were bringing in the maize, they were bringing in the chicken, they were bringing in all that. But with time, they have now collapsed. GEM collapsed, NACMAT collapsed. They were entering. And then others, through the farmer participatory research trials, we were getting the seed, but within the shortest possible time, it was not coming out. So the labeling was also another important aspect, which the GMO bill was not looking at, because we needed them to be marked and then easily traced what happened. And even when it comes on the shelf, that this is GMO-produced banana from this place. In conclusion, the gaps, the bill, so now the commercialization boom has gone down. Those gaps had to be answered first before the commercialization could go in place. And often, when we brought in this criticism, it was thinking that maybe we don't want technology. It's not only that we don't want technology, but we want technology that is relevant to especially the smallholder farmer and within our context. So when I hear the professor said the case-by-case aspect, it is important. We are not saying that we don't want it, but we have to follow slowly and have a case-by-case basis. And we shouldn't forget that it's not only the solution to elimination of hunger. No. For our case, there are several issues that are supposed to be on these, and let us leverage on these aspects that will not let the smallholder farmer extinct. So, What are these? It's important to look at our policy and governance, which is important, and this was the biggest bottleneck for the commercialization of these GMOs. And then we need to integrate and involve the young people, because they'll easily comprehend what is happening, and they will have another school of thought on it. But also, for our case, we need to harness the potential in scale and voice through organization of these farmers, and our farmer and governments have to invest in agriculture. For instance, yes, we have had a drought, but have we looked at irrigation? Have we looked at systems that can help, apart from having a drought tolerant breed? And then climate change, a lot has to be done. It has been a bit long, but thank you so much.
Thank you so much. If you have a question or two, we'll open for that. If not, we just proceed. Mm-hmm. One question for you, Trina. Short one.
Thank you for your presentation. It was very interesting, and you are the reason we are here today, so it's very important to listen to what you have to say. I have a comment on the GMOs that you claim that have already arrived in Uganda, and I'm thinking, how could that happen? And I'm thinking one step further, and I answer that question, and that's because you don't have a legislation. Because if you had, it would be illegal unless the authorities had approved. So I think you better have the president sign that law and then have a case-by-case legislation and a precautionary principle, and then you wouldn't, then South Africa wouldn't dump their GMOs on you.
Okay. I could give several reasons why they have been there. One is that we are trying to integrate trade within the region. So our borders are porous. So we get products from Kenya, we get products from South Africa, we get products from Sudan, and they easily get in. And this was the reason as to why the GMOs were on the market, because the president liberalized our markets. And many of these products, they were not coming as live products, they were coming as finished products, especially in the chain stores that were present. Yes, the act is important, but now we have to have solutions to those answers. Because there were a list, there are around 10, I've only brought about 5 of them, issues that failed the signing of the act.
Okay. Thank you so much. I think there is, yeah. Could you be very brief?
Well, it depends on the answer. Thank you.
No, it
doesn't. It's like a comment, but my impression is that the problem of the world is not too low production of food, it's poverty, which is the problem. Could you comment on that?
But it's two-way, yes. And that is why we have those SDGs, and they are also separate. Poverty, eliminate poverty, eradicate poverty, and eliminate hunger. So hunger is also a problem, and it's a very big problem, especially for us in Africa. But to eliminate both of them, yes, food and agriculture can be the center for its elimination. If we are growing very good food, we will fight hunger. We can get incomes and then eradicate the poverty.
Thank you so much. We'll come back to, you know, this very big question. Now I am happy to ask Clara Fischer to join me at the podium. Clara is a researcher of the rural development at the Swedish University of Agricultural Sciences, SLU.
Yes.
We are looking forward to hear your introduction. Please, Clara.
Thank you. Hello. So I'm from the Swedish University of Agricultural Sciences, and I'm a social scientist. I'm at the only social science department at the Agriculture University. So I'm doing social science research on agriculture, broadly. And I was invited here today to talk about the broad topic of socioeconomic aspects of GMO in Africa. But I thought that it would be more... Sorry, something is happening here. Hang on. No, it's okay, it's okay. I think it's more relevant to talk of a specific case. And especially now when I'm the last person here and I can see that the other presentations haven't been so specific on specific case studies, I think that it's even more relevant. So I will talk to you in a very, very short summary of my PhD thesis, which was finished in 2013. And was about smallholder farmers in South Africa growing BT maize. So today on the market, almost all GM crops are either herbicide tolerant or insect resistant. There are other crops on the market that take small market shares that you have heard of today, but it's still these crops that really dominate the whole global market. Herbicide-tolerant crops are the most common ones. After that is insect-resistant crops or BT crops. The insect-resistant crops have been modified to have genes producing a toxin from a soil bacterium and that kills certain pest insects. And the crops that are modified today are mainly soybeans, cotton, rapeseed, and maize. Then there are these other crops that people have talked of today, but they take like promille of the market still. Maybe a change in attitude or regulation or increased funding to publicly funded research could change that, but this is how the situation is today. So these, if we want to know about how it works when smallholder farmers grow GM crops, it's these crops that we have to study, because that's the only thing that there is to study still. If you want to study something in actual reality, where people grow crops under their everyday conditions. So I wrote my PhD thesis on smallholder farming in South Africa. And they were introduced to BT maize through a state-run agriculture development program. And I will give you a little bit of background of the region. I should have had a map, but my fieldwork was in the Eastern Cape region of South Africa. The nearest town is called Flagstaff. Not even South Africans from the bigger towns know what Flagstaff is. It's a very remote place in the Eastern Cape. In this place, people rely on wage labor and social grants and maize agriculture in combination. The statistics from when I wrote my thesis is that 68% of the working population are unemployed and 82% of all people are classed as poor, if you count poverty as having under $2 per day. Maize is the staple crop. It is eaten every day for all meals and often together with some beans and pumpkin. But it's people eat a lot of maize and people plant maize. The maize you produce is not enough, so people also purchase maize in the shops. And maize is commonly intercropped with beans and pumpkin in the field and with a variety of vegetables in the garden. So maize is a cross-pollinating species, and it exists commercially in the shops as open-pollinated and hybrid varieties, and in South Africa also as genetically modified varieties. So open-pollinated maize varieties in general, I will just, you can read my thesis if you want more details, but in general, open pollinated varieties don't give as high yield, but there are open pollinated varieties that are better adapted to suboptimal farming conditions. Whereas hybrid maize varieties is the maize that all commercial farmers grow. It gives higher yield, but the hybrid varieties that we have are developed to suit more optimal farming conditions where the maize gets enough rain and enough fertilizer. Then there are also BT and Roundup Ready maize in the shops in South Africa and also in this little town nearest the villages where I worked. And these with stacked traits, which means that it's both BT and Roundup Ready together. And those, the GM crops, are hybrid maize with the GM components in them. And also, open pollinated varieties work better if you take your own seed and plant again, whereas hybrid, if you take your own seed and plant hybrid varieties again, the yield is reduced. But studies with smallholder farmers in many African settings have showed that it's often still economically beneficial to take hybrid seeds and plant them again. The yield is reduced, but it's not massively reduced. So in the villages where I did my field work, I was in three villages. Most people grow open pollinated maize, and they purchase new seed now and again, but not every year. Or they purchase part of their seed stock and not the whole. And people in general, they don't know the difference between hybrid and open pollinated or GM. They go for the varietal names that they are used to. They say, I buy Sahara or I buy Silver King. And they ask for the maize with that varietal name. But often they ask for names of varieties that don't exist anymore. But then in the shop owner doesn't tell them that, no, this is outdated. They just give them another type. Or they say that, oh, if they ask for Sahara, I give them this one because it's similar. And also many retailers know very little about the maize seed that they sell. And maybe the shop owner knows, but not the people at the counter. And also sometimes the shop owners don't know. I interviewed several retailers who were unaware of which of their maize were Roundup Ready and which was BT maize, or even if they even had those in their shop. You can, in South Africa, if you read on the package, the varietal name has a number, and then if it's BT, it's a B in the end. If it's Roundup Ready, it's R in the end, or it's BR. So you can read on the package. But most retailers didn't know this, and they didn't really know what they were selling. And also, the genetically modified varieties, when the retailers sell these, the farmers are supposed to sign a technology licensing agreement from Monsanto, which is Monsanto has been bought up by another company, but this time it was Monsanto. And they have a technology licensing agreement where farmers agree to certain things. For example, that they will not save seed and that they will not share seed with others. But these agreements were very seldom signed in this case, which means then that the farmers are not bound by the agreements. But. So on the picture you see here, the small yellow cob is a local open pollinated variety, and the one next to it is probably a BT maize. But because of this sort of fluid and unclear situation, I cannot be sure. So now I will tell you a little bit about the case. So in the beginning of 2001, Monsanto conducted field trials with BT maize in these villages. And people who attended the information meetings on BT maize were informed that the BT maize kills stem borers, so you don't need to treat the maize for stem borers, and that's what the BT maize does. And I should also say that this region of South Africa is quite highly affected by stem borers, and stem borers reduce maize yields, so the BT maize seemed like an appropriate technological solution in that context. So BT maize was introduced under its commercial name, Yield God. And people were also told that they should plant refugia, which is that you plant a certain amount of conventional maize together with the BT maize, either mixed or as a border around. And the purpose of the refugia is to delay insect resistance buildup to the BT toxin. And the BT maize package, they got 10 kg bags of BT maize. And inside the 10 kg bag was a small bag with conventional maize seeds that was supposed to be planted as refugia. And during the trials, Monsanto also informed about their Roundup Ready maize at the same time in these villages. And the people were also informed that the BT maize is the type of maize that you eat until it's finished. It was introduced with the name Uslambuke, which means the maize you eat until it's finished. And the purpose of introducing the maize with this name was for people to understand that they should not save seed and plant again, because it was a hybrid maize variety that doesn't produce so well, but also because of the technology licensing agreement, which the farmers never signed. So, and then subsequently, between 2003 and 2005, for three seasons, people in these villages grew BT maize that they were given from the Department of Agriculture. Sorry. Nu kom den igång. Nähä. Jag tror jag köper den här. Jag gör så. Nej, men nu vänta. Nähä. Prova. Nu. Vad tryckte du? Varför? Nej, det funkar inte för mig. So, as you can see when I explain the information that people got, maybe you have realized that this created quite a lot of confusion in the villages. So, for example, the fact that people were informed about BT and Roundup Ready maize together created a lot of confusion. Several farmers thought that someone would come and spray on their maize so that they couldn't intercrop the maize with pumpkin and beans. But this wasn't the case because they weren't given Roundup Ready maize, they were given BT maize. But because they were informed about both of these types at the same time, this confusion, it's not so strange that that confusion came up. And also, hardly anyone had understood that the BT maize was resistant to stem borers, which is the purpose with the BT maize. And I see two main reasons for this, both that the information that people were given from Monsanto was not done in a very interactive way at all. It was just one-way information, and no one checked that people had actually understood what was said. And also that many farmers who were planting the BT maize or were given the BT maize from the government didn't attend the information meetings. And this is something that you can expect, I would say. That there are many people who don't attend meetings, and that you need to have more a more thorough information and dialogue when you introduce these kind of new technologies. Also, people didn't understand the purpose of planting refugia. And there were many hypotheses about this little bag in the big bag. For example, a common misunderstanding was that this little bag that you got with the big bag of BT maize was a promotion that you could give to your neighbor if they want. So many people who had like neighbors who weren't planting BT maize, they gave the little bag to the neighbor so that they could also try. And that little bag wasn't resistant to BT maize. And I will read this quote to you, because the fact that people didn't understand refugia, I think in itself it's not so strange, because it's a complicated concept if you don't know how insect resistance builds up. But actually the person from Monsanto who introduced the farmer to this didn't understand it really either. So here's my interview with the person at Monsanto who introduced BTMAs to these farmers. So it says that if they buy a cultivar that is resistant against stock borer damage, there is a small bag in that big bag with an ordinary cultivar that is not resistant against stock borer damage. We recommend that they plant these two or three lines of this small bag before they start planting the maize that is resistant against stock borer. So that is correct, that you plant those lines and then you plant the other as well. But then, so you don't want to kill all the maggots of the stock borer. You provide them a feeding ground of those two or three rows that they can feed on, you know, so the farmers can see, because, okay, if you kill all the stock borer maggots, you don't need BT maize anymore. So the reason for the small bag, it's only like a promotion. Yeah, like a promotion. So it's not so strange that people thought that the small bag was a promotion, because that is probably what he said to them, because that is what he said to me. I mean, it's correct that you have the conventional maize for the stock borer to feed on. So it provides a feeding ground so that they don't all die of the... The more or less resistant insects will breed together and it slows down the resistance. But he explains it as if we kill all the stock borer maggots, we can't sell our BT maize anymore, so it's no point. So probably he was a good salesman, but he wasn't a biologist. So from this example of all the misunderstandings that the BT maize created, I think we can conclude that people didn't plant refugia, as you can understand, because they didn't understand the purpose. But in reality, as another Monsanto agent told me, since there are so many people planting conventional maize around the BT maize, there is a refugia going on. So biologically, it wasn't the problem. But it was a problem that people didn't understand. People save seeds to replant next year because that is what they do, and it's an important part of having enough seeds and an important part of seed security. People were also feeding the seed to the chickens, which is a problem because the seed was coated. What do you call it? It hasn't got to do with it that it's genetically modified, but the seeds were coated with toxin to prevent. Yeah, but in English.
Dressing.
Yeah. And they were giving seeds to neighbors that didn't attend the meetings, which is what you do normally. I mean, you share seed, and if you don't have seed another year, you expect someone to give you some seed. And also the chief of the village distributed BT seeds to those who wanted, irrespective of if they had attended the information meetings or not. So apart from these misunderstandings with the BT maize, which I think it's important, I will come back to this because it's not specific to this case in South Africa, but there were also other problems with the BT maize. So the BT was bred into a hybrid variety which wasn't suited to these smallholders' conditions. So if the BT toxin had been crossed into open pollinated maize varieties, for example, and maize varieties suited to these the more marginal conditions of these smallholder farmers, then I think it could have been of much more relevance to these farmers. Also, the restrictions on seed saving and sharing creates a problem in the smallholder context. That is not so strictly specific to GM crops either, and it has to do with how the regulation is. So it's something that we can choose how we regulate. And also the variety of maize was very soft and sweet, according to local people, and it was really quickly eaten by storage insects. So many people thought that the reason the maize was introduced with this name, the maize you eat until it's finished, it's because it's actually impossible to store it because it's eaten by storage insects. And this is nothing specific to do with genetic modification either. It's just that most commercial hybrid varieties are softer maize varieties that are suited to commercial milling, whereas the local maize is much harder and less sweet and doesn't work well if it would be scaled up to commercial milling because the grains are too hard. But it's well suited for local storage and it works well too when you mill it by hand. So in currently, if smallholders would buy BT maize in the shop in South Africa, the BT maize costs almost 8 times more than the local OPV maize. So under current conditions, when it's privately owned and it's sold under very high prices, also, as I said, retailers have limited knowledge, lots of spelling mistake there, but and they provide inaccurate information. The technology licensing agreement, I think, is a problem, but now people didn't sign it anyway. But and I think that we need to have a situation when it's allowed to share and save seed if GM crops should be of benefit to smallholders. Also, in this context, I would say in summary that the BT maize did not contribute to agriculture development in this context. And it's not only about the information problems and the regulation problems of BT maize at the moment, but it's also that in this case, agriculture provides quite a small share of local livelihoods because it has been marginalized for so long. You know, South Africa became a democracy about 20 years ago, much later than other African countries, and the black African population has been very marginalized and pushed into wage labor to have cheap labor on the large farms and in the mines. So agriculture has been what women and the old and children do as a subsistence activity, whereas if you are of working age, you try to find a job. So agriculture is not a high priority for people here. So if the South African government wanted to make agriculture a higher priority, the right focus is not to introduce a very novel seed technology. It sort of shoots beside the target. And this broken fence that you see here is an example of that. For example, and this fence is quite okay, but in many places there weren't any fences at all. People graze their cattle freely, and the fields are supposed to be fenced. But many fences are really old and broken down, and it's very costly to make a new fence. And it's the whole field areas that have been fenced, not individual fields. Because people often go together and plow the whole field area. And if you fence your own field, you can't take part in investments, in shared investments. If the government instead had invested in mending the fences, then people would be more interested in planting in their fields, because that, as it is now, many people don't plant their fields because the cattle can come in and eat the crops. So then also, it doesn't matter if you get a new seed if the cattle will eat the crops. So in summary, I would say that if we want GM crops for smallholder farmers, we need to first start to look at the smallholder farmer situation and then see what is needed. Not the other way around, not take what we have and then say, oh, this is a good new technology, that should work. It's the wrong way. Yeah, I think I'll stop there.
Thank you so much. Are there any questions? Yes, there is a question up there. And while you are asking and you are answering, I'll ask the panelists, Daniel, Reinhardt, and Elin Cecilia, to join us at the stage together with Trina and Ida and Denise.
Yeah, thank you for a very interesting presentation. Just one short question. Did they get higher yields?
I didn't. My focus was not to measure the yields, but... And also because people, the farmers themselves were very, they didn't really know if they had planted BT maize or not. you know. Sometimes I could see that they still had the package and then I could know. But otherwise, because of all this misinformation, it's very difficult to know. But the, from what the farmers said, I think that they got higher yields, but I think it's also just because it was new seeds compared with seeds that you have ones. Saved.
Yes.
So it's really, yeah, I can't say really. But they should have gotten higher yields because of less stem borer damage, but at the same time, sometimes they planted far too late and the maize didn't get enough rain because they had to wait for traction and so on. So I would say the variety wasn't suited to the context.
Hmm. Okay, so it's difficult actually to track what comes from the seeds and what comes from everything else connected to connected to that. So please join us at the stage. We have three more guests. I'll give you just the opportunity to, you know, a few short comments, and then feel free to ask each other some questions, and then I'll open for some comments and questions from the audience. And we have 35 minutes left, because I think we should end the meeting at 4:30, which is what we told everyone in the program. So then I'd like to welcome maybe Daniel from Norad, just to make a short comment, please. Daniel von Gilst.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. I wondered a little bit why was I and NORAD invited to this meeting, but I...
But then you understood.
But then yes. I understood, of course.
Yeah. Good.
And I was in a meeting earlier today in Caritas, and they were talking about hunger. And of course, the SDG 2 and SDG 1 came up, and one of the people there were saying, we only have 11 seasons left, 11 production seasons left, before we have to double our production. We have to reduce poverty and so on. And then, of course, in the context here, when you're talking about seed systems and we're talking about production systems and that type of stuff, the time will take much longer than just the 11 years. Just the fact that to produce one variety, a new variety, will take almost 10 years. So, and that's conventional or unconventional or whichever way you want to look at it, it will take that long time. So what is NORAD doing? I mean, we do not support any bilateral GMO programs, but the one thing we do support and which we are, which we find is very important, is the biodiversity of our crops. And so one of the projects which we are specifically supporting is a crop wild relatives program, where we have sort of selected and it's a 10-year program, first of all. It's trying to identify crops which have traits which could be interesting for heat tolerance, could be interesting for climate change issues, heat tolerance, flooding, that type of stuff. So we have identified plants which we should be collecting, which are not in gene banks today, and store them nationally, regionally, and, of course, in the Svalbard gene bank. And we have identified 4,000 of these plants, and they're all now, we're almost finishing at least the collection aspect of it. We are following up that project by breeding with them, pre-breeding. And that's basically making them ready for that the breeders and farmers can eventually use them again. And so our focus has been on collecting and supporting pre-breeding for the maintaining or building up our genetic biodiversity. I mean, all the problems we are facing today will not be solved if we do not have the biodiversity which to come up with solutions. So and the biodiversity is being destroyed. We are losing that on a daily basis, and I've witnessed that in many, many, many different areas. And it's urgent that we at least collect, we save, we put them in gene banks, and then we use. I think I'll stop there, and I think that's sort of my contribution to this thing. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Elin Cecilie Ranum, you come from Utviklingsfondet.
Yes.
Please.
Yes, the development fund, we have basically 46 years of experience working with smallholder farmers, and agrobiodiversity has been one of the core activities and components of our work. And we basically try to do what, from a perspective of the small-scale farmers, and what is what works for them, and what is most suitable. We, just as NORAD, are also very concerned about the conservation of agrobiodiversity. And one of the main things that we do is to strengthen the on-farm management of our plant genetic resources. There's a lot of varieties around. The diversity is on the farmers' fields. We know also, as Dennis also mentioned, that most developing countries, for instance, they don't have professional gene banks. They don't have anywhere there where they actually can store and secure their own materials. And the main part where you have to do the conservations is on the farm. And even though you can store it in a gene bank, you will still need to have the on-farm conservation, because that is actually where you keep all the characteristics, and that is also where you are developing the materials and the varieties, so that they are able to adapt to climate change and the local conditions. We are working, have been working a lot on participatory plant breeding, that has proven to be very efficient in increasing yields. And the thing that you bring the farmers on board, and you identify what works for the farmers, what is suitable for their culture, for their religion. Like the maize, for instance, it's not only a maize, it's not only food. It depends on the color, what kind of food you want to make. All these kind of things are extremely important. And the only one to identify what they want to grow should be the farmers, because they are the ones who are supposed to eat it as well. We work also a lot on participatory variety selection, where the farmers are testing out varieties and finding what is most suitable for their local conditions. In many cases, you have to grow different varieties at one level, and then you move 200 meters higher up, and then you have to grow different varieties. So the kind of one size, so one hybrid, or one GMO fit, does not fit all. We work a lot on intercropping. And we believe, and the farmers also believe, that diversity, both in terms of crops and variety, is the best safety net that they can have against climate change. If one crop fail, then you might depend. Then the other one might save you. This last aspect I also want to mention is that we work a lot on farmers' rights to seed, and how you can actually strengthen farmer seed systems. Farmers, they save, they use, they exchange, and they sell seeds. That is a part of the seed system. And within that seed system, you also conserve biodiversity. So especially the GMOs are also undermining farmers' rights, because they have a lot of restrictions on farmers' use and their rights. So that is some of the things that we are basically doing. Thanks.
Thank you so much. This is getting more and more complicated, actually. and that's the reason why we're here. There are no simple solutions. So please, our last panelist is Reinhard Pretorius from Norges Vel. I don't know the English name for that.
Yeah, it's. I can give you the English name. It's called the Royal Norwegian Society for Development, Kongelige Selskap for Norges Vel, or short Norges Vel. Thanks for the invitation. Interesting debate, interesting discussions. It's a big discussion. Yeah. It's difficult. It's not right or wrong. It's trying to measure and find a balance. But I would like to start by actually thanking Mr. Dennis for bringing the complexities with GMO into context and into perspective. It's extremely important that the demand for GMO should be coming from the farmer in Africa, not the other way around. That's important. Norges Vel has been working with agriculture since 1809. We've been we are the oldest organization in Norway, established in 1809. And work since then with the implementation, execution, and knowledge transfer of agriculture, not only in Norway, but also since 1978 on the international arena. Four focus countries in Africa, Tanzania, Uganda, Madagascar, and Mozambique, with an office in Dar es Salaam. And the three sectors which we are focusing on is agriculture, renewable energy, and aquaculture. Now, on the agricultural part, we are working with rice, on the rice intensification program in Tanzania, and also with cashew and groundnuts in Mozambique. What I think is important to mention, and that is something which we haven't really touched on, is the fact that you have to look at the GMO as the GMO as also part of a very complex sort of food system. The supply of food today in Africa is there, but the system is not working. Bad distribution, bad logistics, food waste all over the place, which means that the supply is there, but we have to work on the system in terms of getting the food to the market. And again, back to what Dennis said, was the market access is important. You have to plan and you have to manage your crop and your production in terms of the market demands. And also ensure by doing that the farmer at the end will be the owner and the guy that's making the profit. Farmers have to be seen as business people. It's a very big focus which we're having in Norway as well. I think I'll stop there for now, and then we'll see how the discussion sort of develops.
Yes, thank you so much. If anyone from the audience would like to comment or ask a question, feel free to wave to me, but I'll ask Trine to make a short comment while you are distributing the mic, please.
Thank you very much, Kristin. I would like to... This is a really complicated issue.
It is.
I agree that it's good that we get all these issues on the table. I'll make it very short, and my most pertinent comment is on the mixture of associating GMOs with multinational companies, because that's what we do, and that is a misconception in one way, but the right conception in another way, because it is only the multinational companies who have the economic means to get things on the market. And I think that is food for thought.
But do you think it could change with...
Well, I would hope editing. It would change if we gain more knowledge on the use of GMOs and have more of the research out of the public institutions that do not require patents and licensing and violate farmers' rights and all this. So I think... I hope it will change, and I think that again that the regulations it's important, but they are the big multinational companies are the ones that gain from them, and that's food for thought.
Anyone from the audience? Yes, please. A short comment or a question, please.
It's not like a real short.
You have to be short because we don't have that much time.
Okay, I'm going to try to be fast. I'm 26 years old. My name is Dad. Feel like I'm a young generation. I think the goal with organic economic is to spread the work to many farmers. It's not right that one farm produces for six farmers, for example. We want more landscape. We have to stop to get richest and biggest. This is the capitalism great crisis what we see today. Stop overproducing material and focus more on organic landscape that grow intact with the nature. Focus on this way will help a lot. We have to cut down material producing by working less fabric and increase landscape. Farmers lose the land today because government needs road. More road we build, more CO2 problem. Less work for the farmers that need to do something else. And when it comes to patent, it's one of the most dangerous thing we do. That means some people want to get rich. It's mean like to take patent in seeds means basically every farmers that using the seeds will work for them. This is one of the worst thing about capitalism.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I think we'll ask Denise to comment on that and on everything that you would like to say. But I've visited Uganda several times, yes. And it's maybe the greenest country in the world.
Yes,
I think so. I think you can harvest maybe three times a year, and the agriculture is extremely rich, even compared to Norway. So Do you really, isn't it, you know, the way that you develop the agriculture that is the most important, because you are so rich from the nature? Please.
Yes, thank you so much. An interesting question. I'll start with what the professor said in associating GMOs with multinational companies, whether it can change. It would change, but as for now, it can't change. Why? Because they have the financial muscle. If national organizations had that financial muscle to invest in research, then it would be very easy to say, this GMO is coming from our own research, not somebody else's research. What is happening? You were on the labs in Kenya, in Uganda, and you can attest, all that funding is not from our national government, for instance. It's coming from elsewhere. So if you can't tell me that can easily change, if we ourselves cannot have the ability to finance the process of research. It has to start from our governments, it has to start from our scientists, and it has to start on our farms, because research should base from there. Then a comment, yes, you have talked about the organic increase the landscape. Yes, organic is a niche market. I've worked on the organic project for seven years, but it's not. It's not that very easy. Also, it's a niche market that we have to look at, and it's. We will not say it's the only solution to our challenges, because we need to produce food, and people need that food. And if I choose to be an organic farmer, yes, it is my choice. If one chooses to be conventional, it's their choice. But then we have to look at the bigger picture around. Are we providing food? Then lastly, to your question, yes, it has to be, we have a lot as a country, grain, with all that, but we need to do things better. First of all, have a very good policy environment that can help farmers flourish. Then the farmers also have to get the skills. Because we are seeing that point that I talked about, you have talked about it in South Africa, about the BT maize, it's about skill. Even if I'll get the best variety, but I have no the technique and the skills of how to maintain or to keep it, it will be all put to waste. So we need to look at policy, we need to look at the skills, and then we also need to look at the markets, because they drive.
Thank you so much. Elin, a short comment to you, and then Audrun from the audience.
Yeah, I think I would very much welcome also the need for public research and public breeding. Unfortunately, the trend has been opposite of the last decades. So I think that's we will still have to wait a long time. But I think it's important also to work to strengthen the agriculture public sector, and that. But it's more. It is much more than GMO research that you need. You need extension workers. You need the farmers need to find out how can they actually adapt their production. You need small-scale irrigation, for instance. There are many techniques that you need. You need to ensure seed security, but that can also be done through many, many other ways. And they are most likely more efficient, and they're more closer to the farmers. So I think it's also about where do we then want to invest the public funds that goes into research and to strengthen the agriculture production.
Thank you. Audrun from the audience, and then Clara.
Audrun Utskarpen from the Nordics One Ecolabel. I would like to comment on the drought-tolerant maize, because it's a very big challenge with traits adapting crops to different climatic conditions like drought and heat. And that's those traits depend on several genes working together, and also they are affected by the local environment. So with GMOs, it's very difficult to make such crops. And that's also probably illustrated by there's only one drought-tolerant maize commercially available. And in a project that was run by the research institution CIMIT in Mexico in collaboration with Nigeria, during 10 years they developed 200 different varieties of drought-tolerant maize for 13 countries in sub-Saharan Africa. And they did that by conventional breeding. They didn't even use genomic selection, which also has a huge potential. And during the same time, they also ran a project with GMOs, and they were not able to come up with any GMO variety. So that's a big challenge.
Thank you so much, Clara, and then Trine. Clara first.
Yes.
Please use the mic.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I think you from the Development Fund, you already said it, but I wanted to point out the importance of agricultural advisory services. And I was going to say in my presentation that it's not the problem of this, the communication problem is not specific to this South African case, but there has been a reduction in agricultural advisory service all over the world. And farmers mainly get their information from the companies. And that works for the large-scale farmers to which the companies sell seed who are that suit those farmers. But I think if development cooperation should do something, it is maybe to invest in agricultural advisory services so that farmers can make their own choices.
That's a very good idea. Trine and then Daniel, maybe Nora does that, but Trine first.
Thank you very much. I would like to comment on the need. I totally agree with everybody here who says that we need to do other things than GMOs as well, and that Africa should determine what they want and not we determining what they should want. And I've just counted. I've had and presently have 10 PhD students from Africa, from Ghana, Malawi, Ethiopia, South Sudan. And they're only one of them is working on GMOs. The others are working on other aspects. But I think it's so important to enable young people in Africa to get their PhDs and then go back and make an impact. So that's what I'd tell them. I would hate to see you anywhere around the world. I want you to go home and make an impact. And that also means to work with extension offices. I know this is really, really important. I've been on the board of IITA, the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture, and their motto was research for development. And they did research, and they made sure that in the countries where there wasn't enough extension service, then they tried to help also in that aspect. Please don't think that I'm all GMOs, because GMOs is part of the solution and not the solution, okay?
Daniel?
Yes, actually I had a sort of a comment on you towards your first question, Trina, and a follow-up also to Ellie's comment as well about GMOs and that it's sort of striking that it's very much private sector. But at the same time, we in Norad keep on saying, oh, we have to work more and more with the private sector. That's also the current government's policy, also work more with the private sector, and that's sort of the way to move. At the same time, also, we also see that trying to reach out to a large number of people, you need to have the private sector on board also. So then I'm wondering about that what you're saying, that it's a private sector, but I mean, we're talking about GMOs in cassava, in bananas, in Africa. Is it really the private sectors who are driving it? Or is it really the research universities and maybe the international CGR institutions which are driving it? It's not the private sector, I think, that's driving that part.
Okay, Trina, I think you should have the opportunity to comment on that. Are you the driver, or?
I can't answer that especially, but I can say that the private sector, which is driving it in a way that they have the patents and they have the technology. But my hope is that when the patents run out, because they do, there's a time limit on patents. And when they run out, then these technologies will be much more democratic and widespread. So we are now the first. Dennis said that the first GMO in Africa, or maybe it was either, it was in 1998 that was commercialized in Africa. That's only 4 years after the first in United States. So Africa is not that far behind. This is a very recent technology, but it's also a long time ago.
Elin and then Ida.
Yeah. Well, I think the most important thing we can do if we are going to ensure food production and food security in the future, and especially for Africa, is to just make sure that we conserve the biodiversity that we have, the plant genetic resources. And because that is where we actually have the basis. And I think it's also, and it's a question about where you want to invest the money. And then it's also extremely important that you work on the international frameworks. And yes, patent law, patents, they expire after 20 years. But that also means that you have 20 years where no one else can do research and breeding on this.
We are allowed to do research, but it's when it comes to commercialization that they ask for the licenses.
Okay. But anyway, I think we should basically focus especially on conserving the biodiversity and to keep the pool of plant genetic resources so that you're able to do research and the breeding. And I think conventional breeding is efficient. They are able to produce a lot of good varieties and they are more accessible for the farmers. So I think it's also about who are we going to do these kind of things for? And if it is for the farmer, we have to make sure that they are accessible and that they are in line with what the farmers prefer.
Thank you so much. On my list is Ida and then Reinhard. And I can't see anyone else from the audience that would like to ask a question. And if that is the case, still the case, when Reinhard has commented, then I'll give the last word to Denise. And you will try to summarize. But because I'm not able to do that. No, you could have the final comment, I think. Feel free to comment, because I think we've learned it's complicated. There's not one easy answer to the challenges. Ida, and then Reinhard, and then Denise.
Yeah, just want to comment quickly on what Daniel brought up about who's driving this, the private sector, etc. And one big stakeholder that we don't have to forget in this is the big donor agencies, these big philanthropic multilateral foundations. Maybe they are driving some of this as well. There's a lot of money in there, so that's just a little food for thought.
Yeah. Mm. Right. Reinhard, please.
I'll just have a quick comment in terms of, in terms of implementation or distribution of, for example, GMO. Everything it's about the implementation of it. You know, you have to, if you want to succeed with something, you need to ensure that the processes also on local level are sort of taken care of. It's all about organizing these farms, for example, into groups, units. It's about the knowledge transfer. It's about the information. It's about access to information to give these farmers the right information in terms of GMO, for example, which are having pros and cons. So I think that's an important part of not only implementation of or distribution of or getting GMO into sort of different countries and farms and things, but also in terms of everything else you do in Africa or in Norway for that matter. You have to ensure that the processes around these things are taken care of in such a way that you will succeed. That's one thing. My other point was just that what we see as well is that I think someone has mentioned that who are actually the real winners in this debate in this plan of GMO. You know, if you are starting to jeopardize potential environmental health or biodiversity, human health, who will take that bull? At the end, it will be the government from that country and that region that will take the bull in terms of taking care of people's health when something fails. So. My conclusion basically is that I think generally our project areas where we work at this, we see that our farmers are tired of being a type of a test bunny, being piloting new concepts and new ideas and new technologies all the time. They want to move forward. I mean, we want to see trade, we want to see business. And let's don't forget that.
Thank you so much. Dennis, the last word is yours.
This is very hard for me. But first and foremost, thank you for the invitation and for coming and for my time here. Hope I've had also some good insights here. But one important thing that I want to conclude with is that, yes, the question was, are the GMOs the solution? What are they aiming at? We are looking at eliminating hunger and poverty. And they're targeting our biggest sector, which is agriculture, especially for us, because that is where we are supposed to leverage. That is where we are supposed to grow and to have changes. But they can be part, but they are not the final solution. They can be part, but they're not the final solution. And it's very complicated to have them into our systems because of more and more, especially because of those unknown answers. Yes, the researchers will provide the basis for this in terms of, for instance, if they're producing high-yielding disease tolerant and all that, but then they also have to help us, especially if you're saying that the GMO is not working. Most of the times one will say you are not informed. You're not a researched person. So help us build that informed consent, informed background in order for the GMOs to move or to be out. Because if we are not informed, it was very good that you ended with something that is hypothetical, but also one that can be under research. The Kenyan farmer thought that fear of new things, yes, fear of I wrote it down, and then fear of the unknown and trying new things can sometimes make people very poor. Yes, but also the opposite. New things can also make people poor. So we have to be very careful on where to move. And my last points were also taken up by him in that there is a lot that we are supposed to do, but the solutions are far more than the GMOs. We need to include especially knowledge transfer, which is important. I'll give you an example. I left the agriculture class when we were 63 students. And only four of us, are in the agriculture field. We were being produced more as extension agents, not as actors within those who can do the farming. So you get it? Because we have to be part of the solution. And it's very important, like you said, that the PhD people come and create a change, not only to seek to work for FAO or for big NGOs, but try to create the change. And it's a few of these people who are trying to create change, not within at the local level. So it's important that we all work together, especially the people in Europe, to help us and move with us in having an informed research and an informed decision on the GMOs. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for summing up this discussion in a very balanced way, because it's complicated. I've learned a lot during these few hours, and I think that we need to be humble and asking questions when we are
trying to collaborate with African farmers and African organizations in developing a better world and to fight poverty and hunger. Thank you to the rest of the panelists for joining us. These are the coming meetings from Biotechnology Rode. And please notice that our website is full of information, both from the latest news and background. So if you would like to have some more information about the topics we've discussed today, feel free and visit our websites. And then we are discussing, Biotechnology Rode is now discussing the Norwegian legislation or how we deal with the applications for GMOs. And we are trying to conclude before Christmas, looking into all these 50 organizations that have, you know, commented on our proposal. It's really very exciting, and I hope that we have achieved at least one thing, and that is a more informed discussion about GMOs and about agriculture and other aspects too. So please. Thank you so much for contributing to this discussion. Thank you to the audience.